Hi, my name is Miško Hevery, and I'm a CTO at Builder.io. Previously, I worked at Google, where we worked on a project called Test Mercenaries, where we helped other engineers become better testers. This course is designed to teach you all about the basics of unit testing, the importance of controlling the dependencies, and different kinds of tools for end-to-end and component-level testing. This course will enable you to write your applications faster and in higher quality. I guess the first question you should be asking yourself is, why should we test? And I'm kind of curious from the audience what you will say.
Testing confirms that your code works as you expect it to.
Okay.
It also enables refactoring.
Okay. You know why I test? Because I'm lazy. And you know, it's not a joke. I'm kind of serious about this particular thing. I want you to kind of think of testing as the path of least resistance, right? Testing isn't something that like it's extra thing. It's not like a good hygiene of like, oh, you should brush your teeth because it's good for you, but really nobody wants to do it. You should think of testing as like, actually, it makes my life easier. And to get to that point where it makes your life easier, you know, we'll talk about it, how to get there. But like on the end of the day, you want to get in a situation where doing the easiest thing is actually the right thing. And so I'm gonna hammer this down over and over again, but like the biggest thing is you need to set up your environment so that writing and running tests is easier than running the application. And there are many situations if you think about it, like if I wanna run an application, that's actually kind of tricky, right? Because you have to launch it, you probably have to have some database somewhere. Now you are probably on the login screen, you have to log yourself in, you know, get to a specific page, like a settings page where you want to find the bug. You push on a bunch of buttons, something breaks, you need to get it on the debugger, then you want to change some piece of code and you go back in and what do the whole thing again? You log in, go to the settings page, like by the time you recover where you used to be, you kind of lost in your memory like what you're trying to debug. Right? So you want to be able to be in a situation where like, hey, let me just write a quick test. Like, oh, I am going to pull up a settings page and I'm going to do the scenario and look, it's failing in this particular way. And then I can debug it and I can go around focusing on a problem rather than focusing on a problem of like, how do I get the application in the correct state to demonstrate the problem, right? Because every time you restart the application, you have to, again, go through a bunch of steps to get it into the problematic state. Right? And so again, you want to be in a situation where like writing the test is actually the easier thing for you to do, right? You cannot force testing on an organization by calling on these high level things of like, oh, you're gonna have a better time or you know, it's the right thing to do or whatever. Those are all nice, but nothing beats just being lazy. So now we have code that will wait up to 5,000 milliseconds. It's a race between two promises, right? Either this promise tries to actually fetch the data, or we have a delay and we'll resolve in 5,000 milliseconds saying like, hey, there's a timeout. Actually, let's make this timeout a little shorter, 4,000, because the 5,000 is also what we test. So let's make a new test. And somebody was asking me, do I copy the tests or do I like to be dry? So I actually like to copy the tests because it makes it easier to kind of figure out what is going on. So let's just copy this test over, remove this expect, and expect here, and it's async. Okay, so now we have the same exact test, but what we're gonna do is we're not going to resolve the response, instead we're just gonna wait. And if I get my test going, notice that we have a test that's failing, and it's saying, hey, I expected to have a response, but instead I got a timeout. So actually this is what we wanna do. We wanna assert that we have a timeout, right? So instead of response, we have a timeout like this. And now you'll see that this test passes, hopefully, if I did this right. It's passing because it's doing exactly what I wanted, right? I didn't provide a response, and it 4 seconds later provided a timeout response, which is exactly what we wanted. However, as you can imagine, you don't want to have a test like this. How do I hide the background? Okay. You don't want to have a test like this inside of your repo because it takes 4 seconds to execute. And if you have hundreds and hundreds of them, this would be a problem. So the question then becomes, how do we simulate this? How do we solve this? And I'm going to ask the audience.
A timeout should be an argument.
That's right. So we need to now pass in the delay in here, right? So we can essentially continue the same exact process where we say const delay mock is going to be a function that is going to be getting a mock promise. So the argument of the function is going to be a number, and it's going to return a promise. And now we have to take this mock and pass it in to our API. And then inside of our API, we will do the same exact thing. We will say we have a delay. And the delay will be a function that takes a millisecond, which is a number, which produces a promise. And oh yeah, that we can have a default value in here, and we can also have a default value here. Oops, fetch. Actually, is that allowed? Can you have the fetch name to be the same as this fetch? I don't actually know. We'll find out in a second. And so now, instead of just calling delay, right, we will call this.delay so that we control. We again get to the other side of things. And if I go back to my test, my test is now timing out, because the same way as we are mocking the other response, we have to mock this one, right? So we assert that we're going to get called in a correct way, and then we do delay mock to have been called with 4,000, and then we say delay mock result, the first result value that we got, we actually resolve it, and we now assert that we have the right output. Let's see. Oh yeah, that's not allowed. My fault on that. The names cannot match, so I can't do this. This delay is not a function. Oh, right. So now the issue is that we have broken our previous test. So our previous test now also wants the delay mock, so we now have to pass a mock in here. We can just do a function like this. I think this is just going to complain about the type. Let's go back. Okay, so now we are passing again. So the same thing that we have done previously, we're repeating over here, right? We are sandwiching ourselves in. So let's say we wanted to navigate with this particular URL. Just to kind of prove a point, I can go here. And where is our Chicago? We can navigate, and now you can see that the default size and distance has been updated, right? So let's say we wanted to assert this particular thing. So the most obvious way to do it is you navigate, and then you start selecting things. Like, for example, you say await expect page.locator, and I think I have a size. Locator is the way you find things on a page, and I already gave size a class so that I can easily find it. And then I can assert that size to have text 1,000, right? Why is this? So if you look at this 1,000 right here, you'll see that it's a span and it already has a class. So I've already given it a class so that it's easy for me to go and select it on the page. Otherwise, you would have a really hard time finding things on a page, right? So typically, you kind of, again, this is another example of where you design the application with testability in mind. You put extra stuff in there so that later on, it makes it easier for you to locate and find them and assert different things around it. And we can assert other things. First of all, let's see if it runs. So let's see if our test is passing. It looks like it's timing out. No, it's passed. Sorry, it did pass. And you can see that it actually highlighted the selector on a page. If you click on this thing, you can see it highlighting that this is the part that it's asserting. Now, the thing I want to show you is that, like, you will, like, let's make more assertions here. So we have size, we have distance, that should be 450. And we have min cluster size. And let's say that's, I think that's 10. What is the default? No, this 5, sorry, the default is 5 here. And so now I should be able to rerun this test and I should have more assertions and they all should pass, right? So they're still passing.